Good morning or good afternoon. I'm Monica Pica with Saks Healthcare, and I will be your technical producer for today's webinar. Before we begin, on behalf of Philips and Saks Healthcare Communications, thank you to all our healthcare professionals for your enduring care during this pandemic. I'd like to review a few housekeeping details. Today's webinar is being recorded. You may ask a question at any time during the presentation by typing your question into the Q&A box located on the right side of your screen and pressing Enter. Our speakers will try to answer as many questions at the end of the presentation as time allows. If you experience technical difficulties, please use the Tech Support tab, also located on the right-hand side of your screen. If you have trouble seeing the slides at any time during the presentation, please press F5 to refresh your screen if you're using a PC, or Command-R if you're using a Mac. And please make sure you are not behind a firewall, as this will prevent you from viewing the presentation. I would like to introduce our moderator, Angela Craig. Ms. Craig is the Critical Care Clinical Nurse Specialist for the ICU at Cookeville Regional Medical Center in Cookeville, Tennessee. She is also the sepsis coordinator for her hospital and is on the Sepsis Coordinator Advisory Committee for Sepsis Alliance. Ms. Craig has lectured extensively at numerous conferences and webinars on sepsis and hemodynamic topics. She's also published on the topics of sepsis and heart failure. Welcome.
Thank you, Monica, for that kind introduction. The title of our webinar today is The Technology Trip Fantastic, Monitoring Patients Today and Tomorrow. And speaking on this very exciting and novel topic is a friend and colleague of mine, Barbara McLean. Currently, she is the Critical Care Program Specialist at Grady Health Systems. She is a member of many professional organizations, including the American Association of Critical Care Nurses and the Society of Critical Care Medicine. She is the recipient of the multiple awards for clinical practice and education from Grady Health System, the State of Georgia, AACN, and SCCM. She has written 24 chapters and 30 articles and is a regular reviewer for Critical Care Medicine, Intensive Care Medicine, and the New England Journal of Medicine. She is a world-renowned speaker, providing over 3,800 programs worldwide on hemodynamics, sepsis, and COVID-19, and clinical monitoring. And I just wonder, Barbara, do you ever sleep? She is the clinical advisor for the Sepsis Alliance, Sepsis Coordinator Network Advisory. And our speaker has no financial disclosures to mention today. And there are continuing education for nurses and respiratory therapists. This educational activity is approved for one contact hour, and a link to obtain CE credits will be available at the conclusion of this webinar. And support for this educational activity has been provided by Philips. So thank you, Philips. And now I am going to turn this over to my colleague and awesome friend, Barbara McLean.
Thank you so much, Angela. Thank you, Phillips. Thank you, Saks Communications, for bringing us all together for this incredible topic to talk about the Technology Trip Fantastic. And as I was thinking about this Technology Trip Fantastic, I want to be able to apply this in a way that is really meaningful for us at the bedside. So part of that journey is really what we've done in the past, where we are now, and where we're going for the future. The topic today is a little bit different because most people who know me hear me speak about direct science initiatives like hemodynamics or acute renal failure and acute kidney injury. But very much the glue that brings all of my scientific and practice endeavors together is technology. And as I was thinking about this talk and thinking about my career, which, by the way, has spanned 46 years, this in the year 2022, I will be 70 years old. So I've had quite a view of technology in evolution, and I really do want to share that with you. But first, of course, we always want to think about the idea. Sorry, I'll put my mouse somewhere else, so excuse me. So we just want to always think about the consideration of what our objectives are for today. We are going to review the development of technologies and monitoring and in our provider practice, identify what the effects of the pandemic, COVID-19, both Delta and Omicron, have had on our technology development, our staffing shortages, and it isn't necessary really for me to tell you about staffing shortages because we all live that every day, and to relate the change of our workforce and the acceleration of nursing shortage into the possibilities of technology in everyday practice to actually alleviate some of our data-driven concerns and to evolve our ability to provide human caring. So I invite you, hopefully, to be joyously joining me in the technology trip fantastic. So first and foremost, to understand the future, to appreciate where we're going from here, we do still have to understand the past. And remember, a beautiful old Roman saying is, those who forget the past are destined to have difficulty in the future. So we always want to remember our past. And I love this beautiful photo of the original Massachusetts General Hospital, which is where I started my clinical practice, not in this building. This building is a photograph from 1821 showing the original building of Mass General. It was known as the Bullfinch Building, named after the original contributors. And it opened with their very first patient, who was brought down the Charles River in a boat, and he was a sailor who actually had syphilis. And the Charles River was the only way to bring patients to Mass General. So most patients, most supplies were ferried in by boat. And then we consider that in evolution, in 1914 at Mass General Hospital, that a very recently developed electrocardiographic machine based on the very original Einthoven's triangle. We look at this photograph from the history of Mass General, looking at how EKGs were performed. And the patient, of course, had his both hands in a bucket of salt water in order to encourage electrical transmission and visualization of the electrical waves of depolarization and repolarization. And we'll fast forward just a tad bit to 1937, reminding us that in 1937 and in that whole history of nursing development, that nurses were actually basically dowried to a hospital. The hospital basically owned their practice. They lived at the hospital. They were on call and available at all times. They were not allowed to date. They were not allowed to marry. And this was, of course, only correlated to women. So young, single, white females, that was it in those days. Of course, we've evolved.
Barbara, we are unable to hear you, Barbara. Hang in there, everyone. We just have a few moments where we're going to try to get Barbara back online here. Can't hear you, Barbara, but you're looking good on the screen. So, Barbara, I think they're going to be reaching out to you.
Okay, we're just going to pause just one moment while we go ahead and get Barbara back on the line. Thank you. We'll be right back with you.
And if you're joining us and wonder why there's a delay, we are having some technical difficulty. Do not worry. We're trying to get Barbara right back on the screen for us so we can continue with this awesome webinar. Thank you. Okay, I have Barbara back on audio, and she's going to go ahead and continue. Thank you so much.
Hello, my friends. So, as we all know, technology is growing and evolving, and sometimes we can have a little bit of a problem. Hopefully, you can hear me now. The voice quality may not be quite as good as it was before, but we're going to move forward with a lot of joy because we were able to resolve it. And that's the beauty of human factor in technology. Lots of great minds working together. So, again, I would like to remind you that my aggressive, assertive, evolutional nursing career in 1976, I actually arrived in Boston, Massachusetts at 9 p.m. and took a cab to the Mass General Housing where I was going to live for a few months as I was actually developing a strategy for where I wanted to live. Thank you, Kathleen. So in 1976, I was employed in one of the first intensive care units for coronary care in the world, and that was at Massachusetts General Hospital. And the reason I put this visual up is that my history began actually technologically with Hewlett-Packard monitoring. And this was the monitor that we were using. This was our central station monitor and our bedside monitor, all with bouncing ball oscilloscopes. So amazing. You only see that in very significant historical records of medical care. So this was quite
profoundly important. This was my first view, and I had been a nurse for about a year and a half, but my very first view of really intensive care monitoring equipment. So as I wanted to show you, this is not me, obviously, but a nurse sitting at the central station monitoring each individual oscilloscope as it portrayed information from the patient's room, and also of having a graphic recorder model. And at that time, of course, Mass General didn't look like the bullfinch. This was really a nice aerial view of Massachusetts General at the time. Now, you can see here is the Charles River, which is how historically patients were brought to the hospital. But now, of course, we have a series of roads and paths and highways that bring patients now to the Mass General Hospital. Now, the reason I want to tell you about my journey at Mass General was because one of the really important things that I was doing on my early journal were things that were new, that had evolved, and that are really, really important. This was really in the late 60s and early 70s, what we were actually evolving in our clinical practice was basic CPR, closed chest massage. And in the early times of CPR, there weren't really guidelines and everybody was doing whatever they were doing to try to resuscitate patients. We were doing transthoracic defibrillation. We were now instituting and placing cardiac pacemakers. And from our view today, it was very, very primitive. And arrhythmia monitoring technologies began to become available. In the 1970s, there was a singular rapid advancement in intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation and also in CV surgery and echocardiograms. So very, very important for us when we're looking at that information to really appreciate, probably not in the majority of your lifetime, but in my lifetime, we've had this profound and significant evolution. Now, this intra-aortic balloon pump represents what I used in the myocardial infarction research unit at Mass General Hospital. Mass General was one of 12 hospitals in the United States that were developing technology rapidly, and we were using intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation with a console that was as big as a six-person dining room table that had to be wheeled by six strong individuals, that was wheeled into the room, and by cut down we would place the internal cannula and attach it to the console in order to provide intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation. In addition to that, the development of EKG, 12-lead EKG, required that you recorded one strip at a time. So from the first strip to the last strip, looking at 12 leads, that would actually engage around 65 seconds in one continuous strip instead of multiple views looking at the same information at the same time. And we think about, in addition to that, what we did for dialysis at that time, that we did, of course, have dialysis at the bedside with a very complex machine. And this was really what that machine and the device looked like. Now, intermittent hemodialysis, even today, looks very similar to this. But of course, we know that continuous renal replacement therapy has evolved past that time. At Mass General, we had nursing education and nursing lectures in the ether dome, the original dome where ether was administered. This was a teaching dome, and you can see our nursing students listening to their nurse lecture. And yes, at that time, white dress, white hose, white shoes, and for many nurses, a cap. By the way, I feel very fortunate to say that in terms of evolution and technology, I never had to wear a white dress, a white cap, or white hose. I always wore scrubs because I was in such a special unit. And of course, at that time, we were using landlines with 1960s telephones. So I love to show this because I'm now at Mass General. I didn't go to school there. I went to school somewhere else. I had been a nurse for a year and a half and I joined. But still, in 1979, nurses who were going to school at Massachusetts General Hospital. 1979, so that is probably not that much ahead of the time of most of you on this call. Nurses were still living in hospital dormitories, still primarily female, still basically servants to the hospital in the exchange for advanced education. And when you look at this, you think, oh, they're putting that up because World War II is over. Oh, no, no. It's over because we're graduating. And they strung their uniforms across Charles Street, which is one of the main roads that lead to Mass General at this time. And you can see all those female nurses hanging out the window proclaiming, it's over, we're done with nursing school. And how fantastic was that? But one of the other things that I love to talk about in the myocardial infarction research unit is that I was one of the first nurses, and actually probably the first, but one of the first nurses in the United States to actually work with patients who had the insertion of an incredible catheter at that time known as the Swan-Ganz or pulmonary arterial catheter. And that catheter was a dual lumen catheter with a connection to the distal tip of the catheter that actually looked into the pulmonary artery, evaluating pulmonary arterial pressures, and actually had another port that through the inflation of the balloon, this catheter did something that was remarkable. So along with all these other technologic advances, this remarkable catheter with the inflation of a balloon actually moved from visualization of arterial pressure to visualization of venous pressure. Astounding and incredible. Now, the only places that were using that catheter in 1976 were actually hospitals that belonged to the MIRU. And you yourself can see the hospitals that belong here. The University of Alabama, Duke, Cornell, Cedars-Sinai, University of Rochester, University of Chicago, Johns Hopkins, and my hospital at that time, the MGH, Mass General Hospital. We were the only hospitals in the United States utilizing this incredible floatable catheter. And that really evolved our practice, particularly in coronary care, but went on to evolve practice everywhere, along with EKG, along with balloon pump, along with computerized arrhythmia monitoring. That evolution was so fantastic. So I want to just show you this picture of William Ganz and Jeremy Swan. And I was really, really fortunate because at Mass General, William Ganz's son was a cardiothoracic fellow. So we had a direct link to his personal phone number. And we were all really trying to understand, what does this catheter mean? How do we apply the data? We were correlating all the data. We were capturing the data. We did have a computerized device that also recorded the data. But it was an astounding leap in our technologic practice. So in the moment, I didn't really understand that, but later I most certainly did. And then the last thing that I want to think about in my transition, in my early growth, was computerized arrhythmia monitoring, which actually was the early prototype of machine-based learning, meaning if it occurs the most frequently, it must be real. It must be contiguous. It must be meaningful. And I was very, very fortunate at that time to be involved, and that was really around 1980 and 1982, to be involved and to have been invited to write a manual about computerized arrhythmia monitoring. It was called Plain Talk About Computerized Arrhythmia Monitoring. Tried to find a copy of the manual in my historic documents, but they have moved beyond, and I couldn't find any history. But at that time, as I was writing a document to help clinicians understand arrhythmia monitoring, I was communicating with scientists at Stanford University who talked in a language that I did not understand. They talked about Fortran and bits and bytes and data points, and I didn't really have any understanding, but my role was to try to implement that information in a way that was going to be meaningful to clinicians. So then, as we move forward, We think about the evolution of Mass General from where it was then to where it is today. Now a conglomerate of, I think, 17 buildings. And also looking at the relationship of my hospital. This is the original Grady Hospital, my hospital today, the original Grady Hospital in Atlanta, Georgia, which was the only hospital that actually provides services to poor persons of color at that time. Now, obviously today, Grady Hospital is a huge endeavor and it provides very significant components and care for persons of all economic backgrounds, all social backgrounds, all genders, all status, all representation of economics, insured and uninsured. And I'm very proud to say that I serve in a hospital that is a public hospital that provides care regardless of any barriers or limitations that the patients might incur in their lifetime. So what that tells me and why that's so incredibly important is that evolution in my history and monitoring, very important. This was the device that we use to capture data on the pulmonary arterial catheter, not the full device, but this one right here. This was called the LEC computer. And today you can see that we use a much more sophisticated methodology to capture the data of our patient and to engage that data. And here you're seeing, I am sitting here with an emergency room physician who is using both his smartphone and our integrated electronic health record to make decisions about the monitoring of our patients. And we're having some discussion about our methodology of monitoring. And then we think about our other situations, that original intra-aortic balloon pump, which required a cut down for placement of the cannula and very sophisticated bedside provider evaluation and methodologies to actually correlate what was most important with that intra-aortic balloon counterpulsation device, which is timing. And then what we have today, which has auto timing and smart monitoring and not pure AI, but definitely basic machine-based learning. We move from there to our PA catheter. This was the original. And today, here's the choice of PA catheters that we utilize. No more dual lumen, but multi-lumen, and the most advanced catheter, multi-lumen with smart monitoring. Smart monitoring means utilizing some machine-based learning and storage of data so that we can make good therapeutic decisions based on algorithmic enhancement. From basic intermittent hemodialysis at the bedside because we had no other choices, to an advanced methodology, again, looking at advances in our methodology with machine-based learning, variable alarm limits, and programmability that actually gives us very significant advantage in terms of how we evaluate and monitor our patients. So then we move from that to this is how we used to teach, and you might see this is me, and now how we teach worldwide, travel everywhere, talk everywhere, communicate in a very different style. Now, this was in 2019. Since 2019, all my education has been virtual because of the pandemic. But the fact that we can do virtual education is astounding. And for me in 1976, naive girl moving to Boston, I would never have conceived of all of these possibilities. From landline to smartphone and to smartphones that are highly integrated with data from our patients where we can track, trend, and follow our patients no matter where we are through our smartphones and how we utilize that information. So I think what we really want to focus on is how the COVID crisis has actually changed how we utilize our technology. I think that the COVID crisis has done two things. One that I feel is relatively negative, and the other, which I think is profoundly positive. The COVID crisis, the pandemic, has generated profound issues with staffing that we were anticipating were going to evolve around 2030. Now that crisis has significantly escalated that journey. So that now we have a staffing crisis that has intensified our threats to our patients. And we certainly know that our staffing crisis has evolved threats to our caregivers. But what it's also done is it's brought to the forefront tried and true concepts and tools in terms of monitoring and in terms of monitoring capability, and indeed in terms of some deregulation that has allowed for technology to evolve at a speed as fast as light in terms of digital technology, artificial intelligence, machine-based learning, and other forms of artificial intelligence that are now with us at our bedside. And there is, by the way, no going back. We have to be able to go forward in this technologic evolution. And that technologic evolution can truly help us in our patient journeys as we move forward. So there's no one more informed than you in terms of your personal experience and the reality at our bedside of the significant issues related to staffing, related to how overwhelmed we are, how exhausted we are, how drained we are, because so much of our care has been escalated into intensive care, even on med-surg units, even on tele units, that we are providing very acute care for a very significant abundance of patients. So we know that that has pushed up our limits. But in order to facilitate our best care, technology and development has increased its speed. It's promoted that development and is asking us to trust and accept our technology. So what's so important about this is, by the way, you just saw an issue with technology, right? We had a minor failure of our technology. That's because there was some issue with the phone. There was an interruption in the phone call. We lost our audio link, but very rapidly, especially related to our support engineer, very rapidly we resolved that. May not have felt very rapid to you. It certainly didn't feel rapid to me, but we resolved it very quickly. And that's the beauty of the integration of human factor and technology, and one of the most important aspects of technology, which is, I want to say it in the best possible way. The only way to trust technology is if you are owning it, if you are driving it, if you are bringing it on your journey to the future. You have to drive it and not allow it to drive you. So when we think about our daily life in technology today, how driven, especially younger people, and I mean younger people like high school students, how driven they are by what's happening on TikTok and Instagram and FaceTime and other communication platforms, which I'm sure I don't even know, Wigwam maybe, all of that driving their future and driving the way that they respond rather than the other way around. We want to drive technology. We want to drive our future. We want to create trust because we are creating the technology. Now, we want to bring that to our staffing issues today. So we know that act safely, that the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, that the ANA, that CMS all discuss safe staffing ratios. So when I look at this, I'm thinking, oh my God, where are these people looking? Because in my hospital, we definitely don't have these ratios. We are not a union-based hospital. We're not a union-based state. And really, the only hospitals that are significantly, profoundly impacting nurse-patient ratios are California and Illinois. So we're really going to think about these relationships when we're looking at our nurse care units based on staffing, based on budget, based on patient acuity and volume. These are actually this is information that was published in 2020, that the desire is that there is one nurse to every two critical patients. that there is one nurse on intermediate units to every three or four patients, that there is one nurse to every four or five patients. So very important for us to appreciate this situation, and very valuable when we were thinking about that evolution, that we're looking at how the pandemic impacted our staffing ratios. So as we consider, sorry about that. Okay, so as we are considering, we know that the data has been very significant indeed on looking at the shortage of nurses and the impact on care. So for every single patient in an average nurse's workload in the hospital, the odds of mortality increased by 7%. And the difference from 4 to 6 or from 4 to 8 patients per nurse would be accompanied by a 14% and 31% increase in mortality and in mortality. 14% if it was 4 to 6, 31% if it was 4 to 8. And a national study on the rate of death from cardiac arrest found that the risk of death from cardiac arrest is 20% higher on the night shift. Now, all of us know that that's a consideration. And this is from the study from Linda Aiken. And many of us know Linda Aiken, who really helped us to develop understanding of the impact of nurse workforce and nurse ratios. So from that study, there have been so many other studies that have evolved that talk to us now within the pandemic. And we understand now that within the pandemic, that our ratios now on med-surg units operate basically that most med-surg units with the very best staffing are about 4.2 patients per nurse, and typically is more likely to be 7.6 patients per nurse. Now you're saying to me, how can you have a 0.2 patient or a 0.6? This is the mean average of the patient ratio. It's not that we've divided a patient into those decimal points. So in the next Aiken study, which actually was published by Lassiter, what was really important during that period of time, or this was all data that was gathered in 2020, is that in 87 Illinois hospitals with 210,493 Medicare beneficiaries, the nurse-patient ratios, after being adjusted for hospital and patient characteristics, the odds of 30-day mortality for every single patient was increased by 16% for each additional patient in the average nurse's workload. Well, that's really important. And by the way, not anything new to any of us. We all understand the role of the nurse-patient ratio in patient safety, and we all want that to be highly and well developed. But are there more nurses now? And are there more nurses for the future? What was really, really important is to appreciate that nursing school enrollment is at the highest, one of the highest levels that it has ever been. However, nurses who come to the bedside have a plan to move forward rather quickly and to leave bedside care. So we think about those relationships, and we think about how bedside care and the importance of bedside care is correlated to, most particularly, the relationship of events, of sentinel events, of near misses, of missed care. And missed care is common, universal, and secondary to those system factors. Most importantly is the failure to rescue. So the human components of care are vital as well, but our focus is failure to rescue. And what is nurse-sensitive care that's been diminished by the decreased availability of articulate and educated bedside providers? So when we think about our crisis, what we want to consider is, does the crisis build enduring change? And is that something that can absolutely happen? Can we have enduring change? So very, very important as we consider where we're going from here. Okay. And really where we're going to go from here is digital communication and continuous care. So the move towards telehealth, the move to EHR, smart apps, smart monitoring, and developing tools that reduce the redundancy of charting, of handwritten checklist charting, the move to voice technology, the move to no-touch tools, the methods to utilize teams to organize handoff data so that vital communication won't be missed when we're handing off. Now, we feel that we've done a good job with SBAR communication. That's helped to develop some strategies, but it isn't nearly enough. And so we think about this as it relates to the rapid explosion in basic artificial intelligence that has introduced the possibility of aggregating data, big data, multi-systems, many hospitals, lots of different patient groups, to bring that data together in powerful models that then produce algorithms that actually teach themselves, actually evolve, actually translate into meaningful clinical scenarios that allow us to evaluate our patients and treat them and rescue them in timely and appropriate methodologies. Such a beautiful perspective. Well, you're thinking, so would I be, ha, my electronic health record? Maybe it's helpful, but I spend so much time documenting in my EHR. So when we think about that quantitative data in the 21st century and where we are today, that age of big data and artificial intelligence is just beyond our reach, just now evolving. But what we also have to consider is that all of this data in EHR is built on individual hospital infrastructures, and those infrastructures are not communicating together. So one of the most important issues is how do we evolve our artificial intelligence under increasing cost pressure, under increasing policy and pressure imperatives? How do we actually conglomerate that data, gather it together, and create algorithms of predictability that then allow us to provide better care? Reminding ourselves that for a critical patient, you can have 4,000 data points per hour, and that the human mind is almost incapable of integrating all those data points and formulating a strategy for protection, for rescue, for appropriate intervention. This is where we get to look at the role of our big data and our artificial intelligence. So really important as we move forward. So again, I want to step back here and say, we know that there are barriers in using electronic health records. This is non-patient time. Any place that you walk into, any med-surg unit, tele unit, any intensive care unit, what you are going to see in those areas are nurses at the computer. So much of our time today is spent away from the patient in basic documentation. Point, click, repeat, point, click, repeat, redundant charting, sometimes 6 to 10 pages per hour. And it may be very system specific, but we can say, all of us, we understand that we need a complete overhaul in our electronic health records. And in that overhaul of electronic health records, we're going to have to devise a better methodology for evaluating our patients, for integrating our data, for applying that big data. So when we think about those truths that we live with every single day, we think about that truth in technology that we live with every single day. One of the most important issues is that recording in our EHR is a primary driver of clinician burden and burnout. And I'm quite certain any clinician on that bedside, at the bedside, is going to say, as one of our attendees said, amen, brother, amen. We need patient information to be pushed to us. We don't want to have to chart all that information. We want pertinent information to be pushed to us. I need to know I need to have a push that says to me on my phone, your patient's heart rate has increased by 20%. Not requiring me to point, click, dial, point, click, repeat, point, click, dial, point, click, repeat. But in order for me to know that those changes are occurring so that I can rescue patients. When their ST segment changes, when their respiratory rate changes, when their filter is starting to clot or clog, when their blood sugar is increased by 20%, I need that information to be pushed to me. I don't need to push that information anymore. These data points can be placed into big data algorithms and allow us to do more patient care and less computer care. And that is really what the focus is. So one of the ways that we've seen that that's evolved is, of course, with EICUs. EICUs give us a second set of eyes. They use protocols, pathways, algorithms, information that helps them to say, hey, you're in bed one, but your patient in bed 10 has had a 20% decrease in their stroke volume or a 30% increase in their heart rate, a 10% increase in their respiratory rate. They look diaphoretic. Can you move to that room and evaluate the patient? Now, many of us in this evolution are quite concerned about it. This is very complex, and it's a complex web, really, looking at turning over ownership to our patients to artificial intelligence or other providers who are providing a second set of eyes, which is really quite beneficial. This is a very complex web of ingrained political and cultural and economic factors, as well as just the standard kind of influence on healthcare of patient ownership. And one of the most important issues is culturally to be able to say, I don't own this patient and I don't own their data. The data can be utilized to predict who's going to suffer a hypotensive event, who's going to suffer AKI, how can I use that data to reduce the time that I have to spend monitoring simple data that can be better, more effectively, and more accurately monitored by machines. So machines push to me the information that I need in order to assure that we're providing the best possible health care. So it is really important to think about how technology can assist us and what is next on our journey. So taking a look at this, you see, this is a fantastic document from the Healthcare Technology Magazine. It talks about the future of nursing in 2020 to 2030 and the integration of artificial intelligence and methodologies to better evaluate our patients, to reduce the time that we have to spend looking at numbers, charting numbers, without actually having an integrated platform of predictability. And that is what is really profoundly important. So I'm here to tell you, I've been on this journey a long time, and please forgive me if I said, I was really talking about the MIRU and not really coronary cares, because we all know coronary care started in 1970. So I may have offended some folks in the audience. They were in coronary care units at that time. I was really talking about MIRU, so forgive me. But when I think about where I began and where I am now and where I see our future going, it's amazing. It's a technology trip fantastic. And pretty much everyone I'm talking to here says, yeah, what else is new? We love technology. We live on technology. We understand technology. And then we think about how we're going to grow that technology to do the right thing for our patients. So really important for us to appreciate artificial intelligence. And there are many components of artificial intelligence, but what I'm really talking about is machine-based learning. And machine-based learning is an incredible tool that helps us to aggregate that big data and to actually work with us in every setting. So not just ICU, not just tele, but in med-surg as well, to aggregate and to the emergency room, everywhere, to aggregate data and to actually provide opportunities and learning about patient diagnosis, patient surveillance, patient evaluation. It's introduced that possibility of using that data to produce powerful, repeatable, significant stimuli that tell us that we have persons who are at risk. And to utilize data from mechanical ventilation, from basic breathing, from end-tidal CO2, all the vital signs correlated together in a predictable model. 12,000 people will deteriorate in 30 minutes if respiratory rate increased 10% and end-tidal CO2 decreased or increased by 20%. Those patients are going to deteriorate. Oh, my Lord in heaven. I am a scientist who loves numbers, who loves data, but I can't predict with an absolute surety based on 10,000, 20,000, 1 million patient data points, 1 million patients, probably 500 million data points. I can't predict who's going to deteriorate. That's what AI is going to help me do. And that is one of the reasons I want to embrace this technology, despite the fact that I might feel concerned. So again, I think always important, AI is not like what you saw in the movie, although it is a little bit. It's really about machine intelligence. And that machine intelligence is actually utilized to mimic cognitive functions, problem solving, learning. And in our future, there may be an evolution to the humane factors as well. But for our immediate future, it's the cognitive factors. It's the predictability, the evaluation, the concise platform, the repeatable progression. Because no matter what you say in your practice, my practice too, every patient is different. We also know that patients do have predictable pathways of deterioration. We already know that. And capturing that data over millions, trillions, billions of data points, integrating that data, creating an algorithm that is continuously evolving is amazing. It's amazing. The advantages of machines is they retain all information. They become smarter over time, not slower over time. No offense, I'm just talking about myself. And machines are not susceptible to hunger, to sleep deprivation, to distractions, to information overload, to emotional and subjective criteria, and they are not susceptible to short-term memory loss. Now, the emotions and the subjective evaluation, that's still a human factor. That's why AI, technology, and humans really must work together. So really important when we think about information technology and artificial intelligence in healthcare to realize that we're already there. We are already there. We are looking at AI in all of these different paths and all these different methodologies. I think that the discussion of AI often feels really profoundly scary, because our perception of it is the technology is going to own us. And our history is that technology owns us. That Instagram, TikTok, all these different methodologies actually affect the way that we see events. In the future, we have to be well educated and well informed so that we are controlling the technology and so that we are appreciating that that technology is going to help us move forward. So I think very important, vitally and profoundly important for us to appreciate technologic evaluation. And I'm just going to move ahead here. I'm sorry, I was trying to push ahead to just talk very, very significantly about benefits of AI. The benefits of AI in today's world are that we have immediate feedback on treatment, that we can have reinforcement on pharmacologic and non-pharmacologic management, that we can reduce diagnostic and therapeutic errors, that we actually know that our artificial intelligence more appropriately diagnoses tumor type than physicians. And that isn't a negative on physicians, it's just too much data for any human being to apply when they're evaluating patients. We know that the development of AI and some utilization of from the McKinney data report says that utilizing AI on a med-surg unit in 1 year saves over $1 trillion in terms of patient safety issues, mortality, morbidity. Very important for us to recognize this as we move forward in our journey, in this fantastic trip of technology. And for us to remind ourselves that we don't have the opportunity to look at a million patients and their million points of data per patient. We're looking at one patient or two patients or the patients in our unit or the patients at our hospital. But as we integrate all that data information over time, we're going to be able to change the way in which we're seeing. We're going to be able to change the way in which we're evaluating. We're going to be able to change the way in which we're integrating. But there are some key requirements, and those are what we are required to put into place before we support the evolution of AI. We have to specify how it's going to be utilized. We have to develop strategies that enhance the organizational value, the staff value, don't forget, the staff value and the patient value. And that we're going to have to put into criteria, performance standards, evaluation standards, performance evaluation improvement for the utilization of AI. And above everything else, we have to ensure privacy, security, and the ethical utilization. Now, we know that there are many bad actors in this world, and those many bad actors want to actually hack into those systems. We all know that, most of us, because we clock in and out on the Kronos system, which had a major hack, and everybody's payroll and everybody's time got manipulated. I know that personally because this morning my computer was hacked and my phone, which is why I'm not on my computer or my phone. All my information was hacked. I had to close every single account this morning. I appreciate that. And you know why? I appreciate something that I didn't really understand before, but now I do. I need to control my technology and not always make it simple. We all need to control our technology. The key requirements for success. We have to control our technology. So we just think about those challenges. The challenges of integrating and utilizing artificial intelligence at the bedside and in our hospital system, we really need to appreciate what it can do. And we also have to understand what it can't do. What it's going to do is fill in the gaps for us that have overburdened us. We're going to eliminate in the future, we're going to eliminate EHR. We are going to eliminate those concerns. It will all be voice contact so that in the moment when I see my patient has a dysrhythmia, I can just say, I believe my patient has AFib. Here's what I'm going to do. I've communicated with Dr. So-and-so, and that will all be documented without any clicking, pointing, repeat, repeat, repeat. We also have to be aware that this can buffer up our workforce, freeing our nurses and our physicians and our advanced practice providers to do the thing they want to do, care for patients. We are so invested in our data that we forgot that the single most important thing is that we are wanting to care for our patients. So as we move forward, we always want to consider that future. And that future is here. Here at the bedside, where I'm using a relay device to tell me how much urine output my patient is having, that device is outside the room. And that device has told me that my patient, using that orange line, my patient is at risk for acute kidney injury by meeting the criteria for that. And then telling me exactly how my urine output responded to a fluid bolus that was administered. Giving me that data. So I'm not in the room draining the Foley catheter, trying to count it. All very important. Using device technology to actually evaluate my patient's blood glucose, to tell me when it's time to give insulin, that actually predicts and propagates my patient's reduction in their blood glucose in response to the insulin that I was recommended to give. And utilizing devices that actually show me my patient's continuous blood glucose at all times by an iPhone, a smart technology communicating with the patient's sensor that is letting me know about my patient's blood glucose. By utilizing smart bed technology that communicates changes in my patient's fluid dynamics, can communicate my patient's vital signs, that communicates every position change and percent of position change. And by using predictive software that can tell me that my patient is actually presenting with a risk for hypotension. All of these sensors, all of this technology can move us ahead to the future. And just to show you where I started and where I am now. When I graduated from nursing school and me today, by the way, that was the last time I wore that cap. Our journey is never going to be over. This is really just the beginning. It's a rapid journey. Hang on to your hats. Hang on to your hats because we're moving forward in technology and improvement of patient care for better patient outcomes. But we have to embrace technology. We have to own the technology. We have to control the technology. And by the way, we have to practice good digital health, which is privacy and security in methodologies where we integrate this information. I think the most important thing for us to do in this day and age is to release the control of what it is that machines can do for us, with us, and indeed better than us, and to take charge of what nothing else can supplant, which is human caring. Thank you so much for everything you do. I'm going to turn back over to my wonderful colleague, Angela Craig, and thank you everybody for hanging on during our own technologic little crisis, because again, humans can overcome that. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Barbara. That was excellent. And I know that we can't get to every single question, but you know, just a few comments. I know at my institution, we've recently changed up our protocol for how we document so that we can decrease the intensity of documentation so that nurses can be at the bedside more with the patient. This is such a relevant topic right now. And one of the things that people are discussing, do you ever have a concern that when technology pushes patient monitoring to your phone, it will still take away from caring for that patient, treating the patient, and feel like we're treating our smart devices?
So I didn't hear the very first part of the question, but I think the question you've asked is how will utilizing data that's pushed to our phones change our nurse-patient ratio, and will we end up just treating our phones and not our patients? Is that correct? Is that what the question is? Okay. So I honestly, that's a question that I think is an individual commitment and a system commitment. So I think, again, as we own technology and as we build technology, what is going to be vitally important for us to appreciate is that the potential to be overcome by your technology, treating your phones, doing practice based only on your phones, will be very high. It will be very tempting. It's going to be like the apple on the tree in the Garden of Eden. What we have to do is shift our cultural perspectives and, most importantly, our training. That our training is now you don't spend all the time on documenting all that data. What you are spending time on is responding. So I do think that is really culturally what we have to consider. So in this day, let's just say I'm working on a med-surg unit. I have 8 patients. I am barely seeing my patients for more than probably 10 or 15 minutes during the whole day, because all the rest of the time I'm doing data charting, and I've got 6 to 10 pages of charting to do on every patient. I can barely say, hey, this patient got out of bed and fell. I can barely say that. Doctor's at the bedside, no orders received. Nothing that's really narrative or definitive. So I think culturally, the way we have to actually input this is to have very strict standards by enhancing patient safety acts that say, despite the evolution of technology, this is the safe ratio, and that time is now spent in care, not in care for your phone, not in all that evaluation, but that remember that data will get pushed to you, not every piece of data, but algorithmically the data that enhances your care. So I don't know that we'll be there immediately, and this will be a continuous evolution. I would encourage everyone who is interested to be involved in the way data is going to be utilized in your systems, and to be involved even on a national level as much as you can, to be involved with how this is going to evolve. And by the way, the potential for abuse is very high. And I probably would also remind you that in the desire to bring more nurses to the bedside, more physicians to the bedside, the standards and the culture of education has really changed. So we actually, especially people like Professor Angela, myself, and others who teach nurses, really have to integrate that into our curriculum to talk about how technology will evolve time for care, reducing the digital requirements for us. And I think that is really important. Thank you, because I know that was a really important question by a lot of folks.
Yes,
and I know that we asked, I'm sorry, I know we asked if we could have a few extra minutes. I do want to just address one thing, and that is I had a respiratory therapist, thank you so much, a beautiful question about ventilation criteria and evaluation being pushed. And I would agree, because now in my hospital too, 10 to 15 vents per therapist and really critical patients, it's overwhelming. It's overwhelming. So if all that data could be relayed to you, you would know right away, because you would say, oh, look, I've had a change in the airway pressure or a reduction in the volume when I'm on pressure control, and my patient's PCO2 went up or their PO2 went down immediately, not relying on the transfer of data from the busy nurse to the busy respiratory therapist, and requiring that the nurse is well informed about ventilatory strategies, which they may or may not be, but they may not be present at the bedside. So I do believe this technology is going to evolve our practice so profoundly. Thank you. I'm sorry to interrupt, Angela.
That's okay. Thank you so much, Barbara. And I think it's really important for us all to think about what we can do to be more at the bedside and be with the patient and not have so much expected of us to a computer, et cetera. So more to come. Great information. Thank you. And I'm going to turn this over to Monica.
Thank you. Thank you. And this does conclude our webinar for today. I'd like to remind the audience that there is a survey for you at the conclusion that will pop up immediately. And we would greatly appreciate you sharing your opinions on today's webinar. We thank you again on behalf of our presenter, Saks Healthcare Communications, and our sponsor, Philips. We hope you enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.